put 1,000 lighters in the sky for the outsiders. Wow, I must have had Alzheimer's.
But anyhow, we both pull out lighters for the outsiders. You're now diamond, I'm still out trying.
That's the rap I kicked for him the day he bit my style. I close my eyes, see him as my child.
In 1996, a young rapper by the name of Eminem made his debut to the world with his Infinite album. At this point in his career, he was an underground battle MC signed to the Detroit-based record company Web Entertainment. He was associated with a rap group called Dirty Dozen, also known as D12, which at that time consisted of the members Proof, Bizarre, IQ, Eminem, Conniver, Swifty, Bugs, Dirty Red, Furs, B-Flat, DJ Head, and Con Artist, who also produced M's debut album. Bizarre at that time traveled from state to state to participate in freestyle battles. It was 1994 when he met Pacewon and Young Zee, two of the original members of The Outsidaz. He was battling those two in Washington DC together with fellow Detroit MC Alzai, who later became a member of the legendary rap group Slum Village. After building a close relationship with the Jersey-based rappers, he introduced them to some of his friends in Detroit.
Yo, it started off, you know what I'm saying, I met Young Z in 94, he was on tour with the Fugees, you know what I'm saying, and after the stage, after he finished performing, he had a big fat sack, so we smoked and freestyled together, and he told me whenever I came to Newark to look him up, and I came to Newark and I looked him up, and I hooked up with Pacewon and the Outsiders, then I brought Pacewon out to do a song with me, and who came up to pick him up from the airport? Mr. Slim Shady.
So Pace flew over to Detroit to record a song with Bizarre and was picked up at the airport, where he also met Eminem. They connected instantly and M showed him a few of his projects. They also freestyled together and recorded a song called They quickly became friends, and Pace made both M and Bizarre part of the Outs. While Pace was still in Detroit, they also went to the WHFR radio station with DJ House Shoes to kick a freestyle together.
Yeah, it's Eminem coming straight for your face, chilling with Bizarre and my man, Pace. Yeah,
one.
Giving MCs the blues. Yeah, on the radio with my man, DJ House Shoes.
Yeah,
fuck that. Hitting MCs in the head with the crowbar. Dirty, you're chilling with Justin Kovar.
Yeah.
Dirty Dozen.
Now, it's what a boy on the from the
Dirty Dozen. Pace One.
Eminem, Pace One, Outsiders up in here.
I met Pace through Bizarre. We did a song together. Actually, we did a couple of joints together. And then ever since then, clicked. And then I met Z in New Jersey. I came out like a month later, met Z, met the rest of the Outs, got down with the crew, you know what I'm saying? And then the rest is history.
Before Pace flew back to New York, he invited M to meet the rest of the Outs in New Jersey. He always visited the group in the infamous outhouse, which was a rundown crib that Young Z lived in. It basically served as the recording studio and the headquarters of the group. M was introduced to Young Z, Slang Tan, As Is, Ra Digga, and the remaining members of the Outsiders when he came to New Jersey a month after meeting Pace. They all had love and respect for each other and viewed M as one of their own.
We was junkies, bro. We loved everybody. We was like hippies, you know what I'm saying? Young hippies. We appreciated everybody. I was in Newark, New Jersey, rapping, producing, battling cats, and Eminem came to the Bricks with Bizarre to meet us. That's how that went.
I always looked at him as a distant cousin because he wasn't in Jersey with us. It was tough, you know, being a white boy, trying to go into these New York scenes and rhyme. You know, everybody had to, like, break ground in New York if you were gonna be anything in rap. So I guess when he came to the East Coast, he would come stay at the outhouse. Like a lot of those demos that they did in the house together, I'm not really on those joints.
Young Z and Pace One were the closest to M out of the group. He even shouted them out in the outro of the song Just Don't Give a Fuck in 97 on his Slim Shady EP. His overall disappointment in his low album sales inspired him to develop his famous Slim Shady alter ego, which became present in his later works. The Slim Shady EP sounded nothing like his previous album. Back in 96, he almost sounded like Master Ace and AZ. But from 97 on, he was experimenting with new styles and flows, and basically learned from every MC that he considered dope at that time. He even made jokes about biting MCs back then.
Back then, you know, I wasn't ready. I still was trying to figure out who I wanted to be and what I wanted to sound like. So, you know, I'm mimicking other people's shit.
Working with the Outs definitely reshaped him as an artist, but he also had a similar effect on the people he was rapping with back then. The group also promoted his Slim Shady EP, which sold around 2,000 copies within a year. They also recorded a bunch of songs together. Some of them were bootlegged and others are still floating around the internet.
Had to flee in haste, being chased for some me and J's, but boosted out of some Korean place. I get drunk and hang light off at St. Ives and spray paint the blank sides of all the subway train rides.
He was still unsuccessful with the release of his EP, and working with the Outsidaz didn't help him in any way to become part of the mainstream. D12 was also going nowhere back then, so M was completely left on his own, forced to work at low-end jobs while occasionally participating in battle rap tournaments in order to pay his bills and to provide for his family.
It was an event in LA called the Rap Olympics. Got in that battle at the Rap Olympics, went all the way to the end and lost again. And I was like super discouraged. I just got evicted from my house. So I had to break into the house through the back window, which was my old window. Broke in, slept on the floor, got up the next day, went to the Rap Olympics. And by the first prize was $500. And I needed that $500, man, and I lost. And I was like, I was fucking devastated.
He traveled to LA to participate in the Rap Olympics Battle Rap Tournament, which took place on October 24th, 1997. The winner of this event would receive $500 and a Rolex watch, but he lost to MC Otherwise in the final round and became the runner-up of this event.
And then this kid, Dean Geislinger, walks up to me and he's like, yo man, you got one of those CDs? Mm-hmm. So he gave it to Jimmy. Jimmy gave it to Dre, and I'm back in Detroit now, fucked, right? I have nothing, like nowhere to go. And I get the call, and I'm like, oh shit, you know, this is about to happen.
Dre listened to M's cassette in the basement of executive Jimmy Iovine's home, and was so impressed that he signed M to his Interscope label Aftermath. And then in 1999, after 2 years of working with Dre, M finally released the sophomore album, the Slim Shady LP. The heavily hyped record became an instant success, going on to sell over 3 million copies. Neither D12 nor the Outsidaz were featured on that record. M was not in good terms with D12 when he first signed with Aftermath. The only person aside from Dre that was featured on the album and is still close to M is Royce da 5'9", who became Eminem's rhyming partner and hype man. Even though the Outs were not featured on the record, M still gives them a few shoutouts on songs like Come On Everybody, As The World Turns and Just Don't Give A Fuck, which also appeared on the Slim Shady EP. So Royce and the Outsidaz were his closest associates aside from Dre. They performed together live at Tramps in New York and also on the Slim Shady LP World Tour in 99. But aside from all the touring and performing, he also had to focus on his solo career before he could give his group the necessary push. The Outsidaz had difficulties with their record deals and were still trying to get their solo and group projects out. Pacewon already had a single out called I Declare War, which is a hip-hop classic produced by the legendary producer Ski Beats. They also did a music video for that song, which featured all the members of the Outsidaz, including Eminem.
This year I declare war on the mayor, like let my niggas out the devil's lair or I spray ya. Rock a plow. Outsidaz.
His debut album, The Pacewon Effect, was supposed to come out in 98 on Rockablock Productions, but it was pushed back multiple times and scrapped in the end after the label went bankrupt. Young Zee also had a debut album called Musical Meltdown, which was supposed to be commercially released in 96 on Perspective Records, but it only came out as a promotional cassette limited to 100 copies. The group was also affected by the deaths of two of their members in 1999. The first outsider to pass away was Burks, who was also a member of Dirty Dozen. This led to Eminem eventually rejoining D12 after volunteering as a replacement for the deceased homie. D12 became Eminem's main priority from that point on, and the Outsiders were more or less a thing of the past for him. He even pushed Bad Meets Evil to the side, which resulted into Proof replacing Royce da 5'9 as his hype man and rhyming partner. We also have to take into consideration that the members of D12 reside in Michigan, so it wouldn't be necessary for M to constantly take flights for their recording sessions, which is definitely an advantage over the New Jersey-based rap group. And it's also not easy to manage a group with over a dozen people who are known for trouble.
Different little situations happened that made, you know, that made my involvement with the Outsiders complex. Why did I have to leave them at home? Because they was crazy. They crazy. How do you get a lifetime ban from the House of Blues?
So D12 got signed while the Outsiders were left on their own. The second incident that impacted the future of the Outs was the death of Sling Tan, who was also a big inspiration for M. Some of the members in the group got mad at M for not paying respect for their deceased homie. And one of those members was As Is.
Like, bro, you ain't never went in public and said rest in peace to Slang Tan. The day I think a Slang funeral or something like that, it was the weekend or something like that of the MTV Jams when he won and got awards and stuff. Like, bro, you had the ultimate opportunity to put some respect on my big brother name. You know what I'm saying? I was like my brother. It's different father, different mother. But Slang created the fast style. I invented my own out of it, and so on and so forth. You know what I'm saying?
I search the city streets and shimmy G's for 60 weeks to catch ya. Battle you on each you like Hannibal Lecter. Put the style on a hospital stretcher for trying to rhyme by me. You better off slapping John Gotti at a mob party.
Another incident that hurt the relationship between M and the Outs was the recording of the song Amityville, which later appeared on the Marshall Mathers LP in the year 2000. Young Zee and Pace One were supposed to appear on that song with an 8 to 12 bar verse each. So M invited them to come to the studio to record the song together, and after everybody laid down their verses, M asked Pace to change his verse after writing it for 4 hours. Pace got mad and refused to redo his verse.
I didn't change my verse because, yo, I was just tired. I was spent. I wrote the little 8 bars that I wrote, or 12 bars that I wrote. Yo, it took all day to write it, first of all. It took like 4 hours. We was in there already. We listened to M shit. That's the first day he played me Stan by the 45 King. He was like, yo, 45 King produced this. Listen, my T's gone. Yo, M is my boy. He played all of his new shit for me.
In the end, both Young Z's and Pace One's verses were cut off the song and permanently erased.
We was in the studio with M. We went in, we recorded. He came back and he said, yo, Dr. Dre said I had too many people on my album, so I had to swipe you and Z off. I was like, damn, why it gotta be me and Z? Take Bizarre verse off, man. You gonna do D12 anyway. I don't know why he took us off. And my verse was kind of dope. I don't think he liked it that much, because when I did kick it, he was like, yo, I think he wanted me to speed it up.
Pace One got mad that he was replaced by Bizarre, who in his opinion was an inferior lyricist. But according to M, it was Dre who cut Z and Pace off the album.
I felt like, why you can't include me? Why? Because you are on the top now? That's the best time to include me. You know what I'm saying? We gonna go from hanging every day, making money, you even starting to take me with you to the top, to I can't be on your record now. I ain't fresh no more. You know what I'm saying? So I had got a little bit, you know what I'm saying? I got a little bit grumpy. I practically discovered him, bruh. He was not coming to New York, rocking the shows. I introduced him to Big Pun before.
Pace thought that Eminem was turning his back on him after becoming rich and popular. The Marshall Mathers LP has sold over 21 million units worldwide and would have given Young Zee and Pace the necessary push to kickstart their careers. Because up until this point, they were still underground MCs who didn't even have an album out. The only project that they had released was the Nightlife EP, which came out on Rough House Records in January 18th. I can't read, but I still write to my pen pal. I can't fly, but I still float on cement clouds. I can't see, cause my eyes already been gouged out. I've been down with the outs for 10,000. Bust it, bulletproof on, looking rugged. Pacewon, what? The wrong one to fuck with. Bandana tied in front on some thug shit. People giving me props, love is love, kid. Eminem didn't have the time to work on that project and was only listed as a feature guest on the tracklist. The same could also be said about Ra Digga, who at this point was signed to Elektra and Flip Mode, a label founded by the legendary MC Busta Rhymes. There was already a little friction between the members of the group, as they didn't have the same cohesion as in the 90s, with everybody going solo in different labels and some of the members leaving. The only members of the group who made it out of the underground scene are M and Ra Digga, two underdogs that lost ties with the group over the years.
I felt, you know, I felt like I had the extra show and prove because I was a girl. And I sensed from him that he felt like he had the extra show and prove because he was white.
Her first solo project, Dirty Harriet, sold 700,000 copies worldwide, more than every Outsidaz group project combined.
So there's this track on the Dirty Harriet album, right? Since we're talking about the 18 year anniversary. Fuck your niggas. Fuck your niggas. Every one of your niggas. Every one of your niggas. Don't trust
your niggas. Don't trust your niggas. Fuck all your niggas. Fuck all your niggas. You know, back then we all had different deals. Like I had a solo deal. Z had a solo deal. We had the crew outside a deal. So we was milking each other labels. Pace had a deal. Like we got As is to submit like a 20 grand invoice for the beat for that record. And so, you know, we gave him five, we kept 15 and shit. Wait, the numbers might be psych. I'm just kidding.
Like, what?
Something.
You're gonna be like, wait a minute. Is that what really happened?
Sylvia Roll watching this right now, like, oh, word. Not only is this sample not clear, but then y'all took the record and used it before us after Elektra had paid y'all. So now I got Sylvia Roan looking at me like, under no circumstances are you ever to record with them niggas again. Now I got my label telling me that, you know, you can't record with them cats. Damn, y'all made it difficult as fuck.
Both The Outsidaz and D12 released their first group album the following year, ironically on the same day, June 19th, 2001. D12's Devil's Night album was hereby released on Shady Records and peaked at number 1 on the US Billboard R&B and Hip Hop album charts. The Bricks by The Outsidaz, however, only peaked at number 68 and didn't receive any certification, unlike Devil's Night, which went double platinum in the US. The Outsidaz didn't get any form of support or promotion by Eminem or his label, which more or less confirmed M's separation from the group and infuriated some of the members of The Outs. Eminem wasn't featured on the Bricks album, but one of his older songs from the 90s was sampled in the intro. None of the unreleased songs with M made an appearance. This was the last project before the group disbanded in 03. There were many disputes and disagreements in the group that led to its dissolvement. Everybody pursued a solo career afterwards and they stopped moving as a collective. There were certainly mixed feelings about M and the group before the disbandment, and one of the members who became vocal about him is As Is.
Well, with me, the issue was from the jump. Like, I've been dissed, homie, way back in like 2000, 2001, and nobody wanted me to release the song. I performed a song in Newark, New Jersey, got crickets. I performed a song in Philly, got crickets. And you know what I'm saying? It was just showing me that, you know, it is what it is. Cats wasn't trying to hear me. Trying to say that's my style. Like I said, I was already apart from the group. I left in 2001.
The only Outsidaz member that M was still close to was Young Z, who also appeared on the movie soundtrack for 8 Mile. I got waiting
haze. My customers hoes sleep with me. We have small beef. I still sell them O's for 350.
There were persisting rumors that Z was to be signed to Shady Records, and Eminem produced a bunch of beats for Young Z's second studio album, which was supposed to come out on the label. But he wasn't the top priority back then, which resulted into M reusing some of the beats that were intended for Young Z on other projects.
Pushing the gas when my clocks blast. We was young and we was dumb, but we had heart. In the dark when we survived through the bad part.
M was working on a lot of projects back then, like for instance Obi Trice's debut album, D12's sophomore album, his own album Encore, Tupac's posthumous album Loyal to the Game. And he was also signing and managing upcoming artists, like 50 Cent. It must have been overwhelming for him to keep an eye out for everybody. Z was the only outsider who still had contact to M at this point.
Young Z, keep moving for that Max B Cuban. I make you sing like Big Ruben. Man in the hood, I'm the American Idol. First I fight you, then run up on your stairs with a rifle.
So Z gets signed, but what about Pace? Oh.
New Jersey, stand up!
Every man for himself and things not sweet. I knew this song by that crew Mob Deep, so I used it. My brother produced it. New shit set me up so I could flow like a cruise ship and tell a story about these men that's foul and how this little dirty kid stole our style and ran with it. Even bit our wit and our charm and did a half a dozen songs dissing his mom.
After holding a grudge against him for the past 4 years and with M quote unquote neglecting the group after his rise to success, Pace One finally decided to drop an Eminem diss track called Rap Music, which sampled Mobb Deep's Right Back At You from 1995's classic The Infamous. Pace accuses M of stealing the outsider style without giving credit or the necessary respect for the people he was inspired by.
He went so far across the brain, I should put the choke down. He turned our inner expressions to a joke style. Doing that pop BS, doing coke now. Another manic depressive, getting doped out. I read a book about how we a crook and no good. That's why he hiding from Shug. Why he had to pack his bags and move his things from the hood. So scared he wouldn't move back if he could.
He continued by addressing Eminem's drug addiction and how money and fame changed him as a person. Pace also mentioned the co-founder and CEO of Death Row Records, Suge Knight, who, according to many sources, tried to get Eminem killed twice in 1999. The first incident took place at the Hip Hop Source Awards, where he was approached by Suge Knight's henchmen.
M was walking to his seat, I'm standing off to the side, and M was cut off on his way to his seat, and all these guys in red shirts surrounded him. You see all these guys talking about Death Row, motherfucker, Death Row. I ain't thinking about no red and blue. I'm thinking about anybody that's gonna get within that 3 foot space, look like they about to do something, I'm dropping your ass. So the whole time, I'm on knockout mode or breakneck mode. The limo's pulling off as we're coming out. Death Row's behind us. So I'm like, shit. Motherfuckers trying to kill us, man. What they trying to do? What do they want? I don't understand. What do they want? M could not die on my fucking watch, man.
The second incident took place at an event in Hawaii, where Shook sent 50 gang members to harass Eminem.
We ended up getting escorted by Honolulu policemen, and they're putting on bulletproof vests, loading guns, putting on vests in the van. All you could hear was the locking and loading of 40 cals, Desert Eagles, the Velcro, a bulletproof vest putting on. That's all you heard. You see a sea of Death Row guys. They got on red, black Death Row jerseys. These guys are on the plane with us, man. On the plane. So you talk about one guy doing a five-man detail. The guy wants to wake M up. I said, man, you're not gonna wake him up. He said, man, fuck you, man. I said, let me tell you something, dog. I said, you're not gonna win this fight, man. I said, look, y'all got me outnumbered. I said, but somebody gonna get hurt and go to the hospital. It's not gonna be me. LAPD is waiting. They already at the airport waiting. I said, so you and your team, y'all might want to figure out how y'all gonna handle this. I said, we're not trying to get into no shit in the air.
Yo, is it your heart or is it the lies? You lack courage like the lion in the Wizard of Oz. You went from brunette to blonde just to better your cause. But your hype man album sound better than yours. Bunny rabbit got a funny habit. We say he let a homie and a honey have it. Cause he gay. Well, I'm hard to the core like Grun and Crush Groove. You a little brick that ate too many mushrooms. Got your voice on the track of your choice. You made noise, but then turn your back on your boys. Even did it to Royce. Where's head, where's buzz? I'm sick of your songs, I need lead earplugs. The same thing you tried to do with the outs is the very same reason that they booing you now.
The second verse is dedicated to the people who M allegedly turned his back on. Pace name dropped Fuzz and DJ Head. He also mentioned M's falling out with Royce, which basically made M push his Bad Meets Evil partner to the side to focus on D12, a group that Royce always considered whack. He was then replaced by Proof as M's hype man, which basically added fuel to the fire and increased the tension that was rising between D12 and Royce da 5'9". So Pace was basically saying that, regardless of how close you are with M, you will eventually get stabbed in the back if you're not beneficial for his career.
Slim Shady had a past history. I'ma paint a picture now, you can set it up. Let's start with this time that he was getting drunk. I jumped in, knocked a couple kids down, made niggas bin out, helped them off the grid out. Me and Big Nasty started raising hell. Always wonder why your other boys ain't help.
One time, motherfucking, we in San Francisco, this nigga M on the stage like, what? What? Talking to like, it's a big ass nigga in the fucking... And he with niggas, you know, right. A big white boy. Like, yo, like, well, they beefing with each other. He jump off the stage, boom, then they start mopping his ass. And, yo, his bodyguards wouldn't do shit. I had to come down from the second floor, go down there, boom, boom, boom. Yo, I had to grab the bodyguard, like, get in there, bitch.
See, this is real dirt that I'm kicking on y'all. Won't you battle me? Stop picking on Jaw.
I'm a soldier.
Scary little bitch, you a soldier, not true. The truth just is, you wanna be Pop too.
So when you see me on your block with two blocks, screaming fuck the world like Tupac,
I just don't give a fuck.
I bite your motherfucking style just to make it fresher.
Stop biting, invest in speech, and let my fallen brothers just rest in peace. You never met them, they probably wouldn't feel ya, cause your little rap songs need to be realer. See, you just got a charge cause you shook with a gun. Got yourself in trouble, now look what you done.
I'm low down and I'm shifty.
Low down and shifty, only on camera. Shit compared to him, I'm Tony Montana. I beat his ass, smack him up and play with him. Take that little ass allowance Dr. Dre give him. How many styles can I flaunt in your face? Ask M, he don't want it with Pace.
Ask Nas, he don't want it with Ho. No!
Eminem never replied in any form, but Young Z, one of the founding members of The Outs, recorded a response record called Friends, which was supposed to come out with his upcoming album on Shady Records. The song basically closed the chapter of the group and was meant to show that Z is taking Eminem's side in this beef.
Sometimes I feel like Dame Dash, outside is gone. It's like I lost my girl in a plane crash. I'm trying to move on some slang pass. I'm not trying to get that same cash out on Ace where it ends.
Say goodbye to my friends. I used to get high with my friends.
Young Z's upcoming album was scrapped for unknown reasons and his deal with Shady Records didn't happen. Instead, he was signed to Conniver's and Denown Porter's label Runyon Ave Records, on which he, until this day, hasn't released any projects. His album didn't come out until 09, when Rough Cuts Media released most of the music he was working on. It was renamed to The Album I Had When I Was Supposed to Sign to Shady, and was a Payloads.com exclusive release, which is not available anymore. Even his third album, Paranoia Archives, didn't come out as planned in 06. So working with Shady didn't necessarily benefit his career. But he did release a free online mixtape that year, which ironically featured Cannabis on one of the songs, who at this point was one of Eminem's biggest adversaries.
This is strict
strictly for stunting when you riding around with a Vita Guerrera looking like massaging you down. Bitches hop in the drop, take off they top, my belt buckle pop. They gobble the cock and swallow the shot.
The same year, another Eminem diss track was leaked on the social networking service MySpace. The approach of the song, however, is different from the previous one.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. Time to burn the house down like a lit cigar. One time down in D.C. I met this kid Bizarre, and he thought his little freestyle was slick as ours. So we got up in a cypher and we kicked some bars. He said he had to go back because he was employed, but there's a couple of his friends I should meet in Detroit. So like 6 months later I was on the go now, all packed up and headed out to Motown. Got to the airport and got picked up by Bizarre and one of his friends. Like, what's up, nigga?
Yeah, thug changes and love changes and best friends become strangers. Word up.
But a thug changes and love changes and best friends become strangers. Word up.
Hi, I'm Marshall, looking like Opie. Okie dokie, turn around and do the pokey type fella. But I ain't smug, I ain't a judge, I just call it like I see it. I ain't making this up, We went down to the studio there, bugging out, wilding out like Coolio here, yeah. We did a song called Take the World. I had the fellas looking at me like I raped a girl. Cuz on the song I was carrying on, I was tighter than Kelly Price wearing a thong. I said I'm low down and shifty, when I die I'ma take the world with me.
I'm low down and I'm shifty, when I die I'ma try to take the whole world with me.
Made M and Bizarre Kid part of the outs. Like, shout if you ever in town, then I bounce.
Yeah. After we did Take the World with Me, he rhymed like me more. And then the next time I seen him, he came to New Jersey. And the next I seen him, he had the Slim Shady EP almost done. He blew really quick, so it was a little separation, you know what I mean? See, Eminem blew really fast. He like Prince of hip-hop.
In the bricks performed Dr. Spock, I did a couple songs, signed a rock a block. A little after that, Eminem signed the Aftermath. We was happy as hell, we both had the chance. But here we go now, dude got rude. Started showing off in Philly one night and got booed. Started showing off in Cali one night and got jumped. You lucky I was with you that night, you got pumped.
The Outsiders were there holding him down. Like, I know a few occasions where, you know, folks had to jump in fights and you know, on his behalf. Sometimes it went over well, sometimes it didn't. And, you know, he had the Outsiders there to back him up.
Picking on folks like Everlast. You're lucky having class ain't a class you'd never pass. Picking on poor little Christopher Reeves. If he was living, he'd probably want to rip up your tee and do a couple more things that Superman do. Might catch you in a diner like Superman too. Might act like you Lois and spank you to death. Pick up with cannabis left. Eminem.
The song came out around the time when Proof died, right in the beginning of Eminem's hiatus. He went through a deep depression while being addicted to prescription drugs. I don't think anybody expected him to drop a response record back then, but Pace kept kicking him while he was already on the ground, and dropped another diss track on June 20th, 2008 called The Joker. He was fully aware that M was in his worst shape, and even ridiculed him for going through a drug addiction following the passing of his best friend.
Yeah, I've been plotting. I'ma find where M hiding and put a freaking price on his head like Bin Laden, and then rob him, spray his face black with Krylon. That's that Brick City bullshit that I'm on. Don't give him no freaking shoulder to cry on, or his freaking shoulder will be the shoulder you die on. He's a prick, and when it comes to that, man, I freaking hate him like the Joker hate Batman. Who's the real dude with the dude? Is it you? I heard you've been in rehab. Is it true?
I overdosed and almost died.
Telling everybody to not give him a shoulder to cry on after he lost his best friend Proof and while being in the middle of a depression is definitely a punch below the belt. Which is also confusing to me, knowing that Proof was also a friend of Pace. He might have tried to draw a parallel with M quote-unquote not caring about Slangton's passing, but the verse also includes gun threats and non-personal punchlines, which leads me to think that it's either just for battle rap purposes or for the sake of drawing attention.
What kind of sucker would diss his own mother? The same freaking type that would diss his own brother. The same freaking type that would snitch his own friend out. Come up quick from a lick and leave his men out.
If you're an MC and you mention my name in the wrong way and you draw first blood, I'ma come back.
Niggas bleed like us, I draw first blood.
Niggas bleed just like us,
I draw first blood, be the first to set it off.
A year later, M made his comeback with his Relapse album, but didn't respond or mention Pace or the other members of his former group. But he finally reunited with his bad meets evil partner Royce da 5'9", and negotiated a deal for the supergroup Slaughterhouse, which consists of Royce, Crooked Eye, Joe Budden, and Joel Ortiz. M pushed D12 to the side to finally give Royce the deal and the spotlight he deserved. But many people have criticized M for neglecting his friends, including Cannabis, who more or less ruined M's relationship with D12 after tricking them into appearing on a diss track called Airstrike Popkiller.
You're an MC and you mention my name in the wrong way, you draw first blood, I'ma come back.
You push D12 to the side to sign Fortron 5. If proof was alive, he'd be dying inside.
The same accusation was also made about The Outsidaz and later on about Slaughterhouse, which made critics depict Eminem as a disloyal and unreliable label chef who's constantly backstabbing his friends and teammates. Young Zee also held a grudge against him for not making him part of the Slaughterhouse group and for once again pushing him to the side for something new. A year later, M released his recovery album and flew over to New York to shoot a music video for his song Not Afraid. Some of the ex-members of The Outs took offense to that, as he didn't invite any of the members to be in the video.
Back then he came to the Brick Shot I'm Not Afraid video. He ain't put none of the Outsiders in the shit. Action speaks louder than words.
This was around the time when Zee signed to Rough Cuts Media and reunited with his former teammate Pacewon. Their most iconic collaboration to date is on Design and Malice by Jedi Mind Tricks. Now, fast forward to 2014, where M finally gave the group a shout out on the song Fine Line, which appeared on the Shady 15 compilation project.
Put a thousand lighters in the sky for the Outsiders. Wow, I must have had Alzheimer's. Long time since I shouted them out about time, cause he's been on my mind lately. How Zee, you always supported me, you vows. I will never forget that, and how you guys accepted me for me and Pace. I love you too, you slept on my couch, and I've been thinking about the time when I slept on the floor of the outhouse. Rhyming's all we ever wanted to do, and regardless how life has turned out inside, I'll always be an outsider. My life's been turned inside out.
Eminem looked past all the differences they had over the years and showed some love and appreciation for the group and its members. The first artist to respond with the song was Young Zee, who for the first time ever spoke publicly about M's separation from the group.
Anyhow, my house burnt down, I'm in Jersey now. You ain't care, you ain't even come around. I got locked up for selling quarter pounds down Border Town. You could've looked out, you could've came and bailed me out. Like Dre and Tupac, my record would be selling now. But anyhow, we both pull out lighters for the Outsiders. You're now diamond, I'm still out trying. And since you laid on my floor like you said before, you're welcome to come still knock on my door. I'm still raw and you're still raw, both us raw. So you deal with evil, I believe if you take heed and pay homage, you can finally break even with the devil. Yep.
Zee explains what he went through ever since him and Shady went their separate ways. He explains how he's still selling weed to make a living, while M resides in a mansion with over $100 million on his bank account. He's also wondering why M didn't help or reach out when the outhouse burnt down or when he got locked up. But he ends his letter on a positive note by inviting him to his new house so they can once again hang out together.
Well, my Dear City record was about me thinking M just signed all Joel Ortiz and all of the niggas to the what's it, Slaughterhouse. And I was just thinking, like, you sign all these niggas and you ain't choose me? Like, I'm better than all these niggas. And that's what Dear Shady record was about, me being in my feelings.
The next member who responded is As Is, who took a slightly different approach.
You'll never be another Elvis, long as I'm alive.
kill yourself with a sword like a samurai. Die. Or get stomped quicker than a Sigma Gamma Phi. Crush your ego, kill your pride. Lethal injection of cyanide. Pace and G caught you with a dick in your ass from a bitch with a dick. You in the getting dick from them drags. Don't try blame it on them bikes. All those X and them tabs dressing in drag. Use a fag and the rest is just sad. Homo.
I looked at that whole thing as a setup, a play, a ploy. You know what I'm saying? Because when you up and you don't want to help nobody, what's the first thing you're going to do? Shout them out. Because they're going to think you're still friends and you're still thinking about them. You know what I mean? Plus, he bit slang on that part when he said kick rocks and flip-flops. Slang said kickbox and flip-flops.
It makes my hip-hop fat as your lip got when I kickbox with flip-flops.
And then he also, And then he also said, put 1,000 lighters up for the outsiders.
Put 1,000 lighters in the sky for the outsiders.
My man, the only time somebody put a light up for some people in my hood where I'm from is when a motherfucker dead. So if you're saying put the lighter up for a bunch of dead motherfuckers, I'm not riding with none of that slick shit. So my diss track was mainly aimed at him jacking slang bars. But yeah, you know what I mean? My conflicts was never physical. Or none of that. It was just like, yo, you know you bit the style. You know what I'm saying? Show love.
You got proof killed. He was the mayor of the city. Then shitted on Obi, Canava, McVay, and Busy. Had so much drugs around. Plus proof felt Paulie would slip him a Mickey. Joel Ortiz, Joe Buttons, Royce the 5'9". Money got you blind. Doing this for fun, ain't trying to get signed. Eminem's your slave master. Yellow Wolf got the whip. The other nigga eyes so crooked, he can't see that shit.
The last person to respond was Pacewon, who until this point had an ongoing feud with M, after dropping 3 diss tracks within 4 years. Unlike As Is and Young Zee, however, he holds little to no resentment and just hopes to talk with M again at some point.
I was so intrigued when I heard Shady mention my name. I felt relieved because for a while I was thinking like, wow, my pal bounced in the bottom of the ninth, like when every out counts. And it made me kind of mad to the point I started dissing him. I don't know if you've been listening. The dissing was a cry for help because I was missing him. Imagine that your best friend was fucking missing and you know he's still alive, but you can't get in touch and he's not reaching out to you. So now y'all ain't getting up. And in your head, you're like, really? Am I tripping? What the fuck? Then you see on TV your friend is worth $1 million. So that's why I did it. Let's leave it in the past. Tie it in a bag and put it out with the trash. And let me take this time to put my pride to the side and honor him correctly while we're both still alive. See, I know why his fans come out in form lines when it comes to MC, and he's the greatest of all time.
Pacewon also created the Shady Corps, which is basically an Eminem tribute band to honor and celebrate real hip-hop while carrying on the tradition set forth by Eminem.
After years of me going at him and being mad at him for not, you know, putting me on one of his joints, I'm happy he did that fine line. He put an end to all of that. Then I did the Shady Corps. I apologized to M on record. I told everybody, yo, he fresher than all the MCs that came so far.
I've got the mind of Einstein. Your favorite rapper loves me. He said it on fine line. Ask Royce the 5'9".
99 the outsiders told me I wouldn't last. I'm too arrogant. But here I am, 2 boys, 2 girls, 2 heirs. And they over there on pills and heroin. Forks in their careers, so that's real embarrassing.
Royce, who's one of Eminem's closest friends at this point, was on multiple tours with M in 1999. The Outsiders were also there on some of the events, like on the Slim Shady LP tour or at Tramps in New York. So while hanging out together, they told him that he's too arrogant and that he wouldn't last in the industry. Royce points out that 17 years later, he is still successful while the group became heroin junkies that destroyed their own careers. He also addresses his disses in an interview with Breaking Records Radio.
M made a song where he was bigging them up. For some reason, when he did that, they took that and turned it into a negative. They started dissing him. But not only did they diss him, they all started dissing me. It kind of got on my nerves because it was like, yo, man, like you dissing me to get attention from this man.
The Outsiders then reformed and declared war against Royce with a diss track called The Funeral. Royce, however, didn't respond and the beef eventually cooled down after everybody remained silent for the next few years. But then in 2019, As is, the last outsider who still had a problem with M made an appearance on Eminem's radio channel, Shade 45.
Outsiders, yeah. I'm the dude with the grams, cool with the fams. Get my passport, I'm doing Japan.
This basically concludes our little beef analysis and breakdown. And we finally got our happy ending.
Fuck Eminem!
That's the rap I kicked for M the day he bit my style. I closed my eyes, see him as my child. He was wild. You slept with your adopted sis Kim and had a child and sucked your Uncle Ronnie's dick with a smile. Boy, you wild.
As is came back with another diss track on January 20th, accusing M of biting his style and exploiting those who helped him to succeed. 20 days prior to the release of the song, basically on New Year, he made an announcement on social media that M had to retire the day Donald Trump leaves the office.
I woke up one morning, I saw them storm the Capitol. I'm like, yeah, when Trump leave, M gotta leave. They created a battle, they wanted me to battle Eminem, so I ain't never been scared of a rap battle. It is what it is, a nigga took my style, you know what I mean? He stole my style out of everybody, cause like I said, I was the greenest one. Today is just hip hop, you know what I'm saying? If you think you're the best, you gotta challenge the best. I said what I said, he had to leave in 20 days, and I put my rhymes behind it.
I made that fool retire, didn't I? He will not respond. He will not respond.
Then on January 21st, he released another Eminem diss track called Soup of the Day, which uses a similar beat to a Nicki Minaj track called
Yikes, I play tag and you it for life.
As is, and the joke's up, you get coked up. You just snorted a mountain, they bought a tow truck. Don't get your hopes up, my flow be coke cut. You get choked up, dry ass bread and some coke cuts.
As is not only mimics the flow of the song, but also the purpose of it. Nicki Minaj released that song as the first track after her retirement. As is draws a parallel to it by releasing the song a day after quote-unquote Eminem's retirement, which As is announced at the beginning of January. The feedback that he received from the viewers was overwhelmingly negative, which didn't stop him from releasing more diss tracks. So the next song is mainly aimed at the critics, but it also features a verse from Pacewon, who had already squashed the beef in 2015 when he created the Shady Corps. The beat of the song is supposed to replicate Jizza's Liquid Swords from 1995.
When the MCs came, tell them about the names and to perform some ads.
As is, I saw you on the web. It looks like a couple people coming for your head. They're all pissed off with you because of what you said. And it looks like you're viral now because of how it spread.
Pacewon received a shitstorm afterwards for appearing on the diss. So 5 days later, he released a song called I Got Time to shut down the rumors about him reigniting his beef with Eminem, while also making fun of the stans who came after him.
Cause I'ma keep it G real. I don't fuck with you cause you disrespecting me. You disrespect my hood by telling me take off my flag, asking how gangster I was, nigga. You lucky on that day I was acting cool, cuz I told you I ain't got time for that. But nigga, today I got time, cuz. Today I got time, cuz.
What the Michael McDonald, Patty LaBelle on my own, cause it seems my team's angry as hell with each other and I'm caught in the middle sadly as well. My family has fell into something nasty as Mel was to Alice. I lay a rapper down with that lyrical rat-a-tat, just like the owner of Aftermath, bitch.
As is then released another diss track on the same day called Ain't Saying Nothing.
You're rapping fast, but you ain't saying nothing. You a rapping ass, but you ain't saying nothing.
He says stuff about M that's totally not true. He wasn't the reason we met him or nobody else. He must think Eminem owe him something. He don't owe him nothing. You was already on some songs with M, and that was him doing you more of a favor than you doing him. When I met As Is, he didn't even rap. I don't know why he talk about M stole his style. That's some total random bullshit. I told you, As Is didn't even rap when I met him. He just had a car and used to drive us around everywhere. He was Uber before Uber.
As Is responded with an Instagram post saying that he'll never be a part of the group ever again. But then, after releasing his final diss track, Product of Espionage, the members of the group reassembled as if nothing happened.
Product of Espionage, piss drunk on Pepsi and Scott.
Bring death to you guys, M's a product of espionage. Beat
to the death with a pair of skates. Out of Wayne Gretzky garage.
Outsiders, bitch.